everyone introduce themselves, please? Start with you. Hey, listen, thanks for coming out here. We are completely out of our minds about this. I don't know how you're feeling, but, you know, we used to come here as kids to this very show. This was a big show for us when we were younger. In fact, my biggest memory of you is at this show.
Oh, really?
Yes, we were, this is a long, long time ago, and we were out and about, and I was standing, I was talking next to David Mack, and you walked up to me and said, do you want to see me blind myself? And we said, what? And then you poured vodka on your eyes, and you blinded yourself. And we were like,
those ring a bell.
Yeah, and he goes, does he do that? I go, I don't know what's happening. And then you walked away, and that was it. And then every once in a while, I see that you might run for King of Scotland or something, and I go, what? He blinded himself with vodka, he can't run for anything.
This is why Scotland's screwed, you know, that's...
My other great memory of you, Mark, is that for all the formative years we were at Marvel, we would do retreats. We'd go to these publishing retreats, yeah. And I would say something, and there wouldn't be much reaction. And then you would say the exact same thing with your Scottish accent, and Joe would go, I like this idea. And it would happen so often that Bo would turn to me and go, you need to work on your accent. Because it was literally like I go, I think Wolverine should be on the Avengers, crickets. Go, you know, when I was a wee boy in Scotland, we used to buy the Justice League of America. It had all the superheroes in it for just a dime. And then they would listen to you. Anyway, how are you, and do you get Netflix for free?
Do you know what I don't?
But you don't get Netflix.
What I do is I've got a relative who gives me his code, and I kind of get it for free. You know he's terrible. I'm not even kidding. My nephew is a student, and he pays for it, and I don't pay for it.
And I, one of the creators of Jessica Jones, actually pays for Netflix. There you go. No, for those who don't know, I was sick in December. You've had this.
I didn't know you were sick.
Well, thanks for having me.
Right, yes.
He has me on mute on Twitter. Anyway, so, I had a MERS infection. I actually went septic last December. It was literally the week after I had left Marvel for DC. I had gotten very, very sick as I've ever been. And I know in the past you had serious issues as well, but this was out of the blue, out of nowhere. I just was hospitalized for weeks. And my wife, who was here, saved my life at least three times. No joke. So. And then I got better,
yeah.
And then I stopped talking about it, so everyone kept worrying about me because I've just stopped talking about it, but I'm just like moving on with my life, you know, but I am better, but I'm okay, but when I don't talk about it, people get scared that, oh, he's lost a lot of weight, and but I'm just so everyone who asks me online, I'm totally okay, everything's fine.
Just not like exercising or something?
No, no, I lost the weight before I got sick. In fact, losing the weight saved my life. Right. For those who are on the fence about whether you should or shouldn't, because I literally, like 10 doctors were like, yeah, if you don't lose the weight, you wouldn't be here.
Now you're looking good? You feel like
now I feel great, but I had lost weight based on healthy brain activity.
Right.
And then I got sick unrelated, and now I'm okay.
Is there any way to lose weight without exercising or dieting? Because I'm trying to do it without both of those things.
Well, it ends up, I'm an extreme case. It ends up I was eating like 30 to 40,000 calories a day as I was stress eating through my Ultimate Spider-Man run for 18 years. So, and then it occurred to me, if I stop doing that, because I still ride my bike like all day, but I'm just consuming an amazing amount of food, and I just stopped and gone. It was gone in 2 seconds. So it was, my body did not want to be heavy at all. It was crazy. So.
And like he said to me, did you and Bendis anticipate this when you went to Marvel? They said, here you are doing this crazy retrospective of the most fun 18 years, isn't it? You know, we were like younger than Justin Bieber, I think, when we went to Marvel, when we were like 30. And there couldn't have been two less likely people to work. You know, it's like we were both indie guys. I was completely failing at DC Comics, you know, just like getting nowhere.
Well, you were more than failing. You were burning it down as you were going. You were throwing babies out windows.
I left DC, I wrote a resignation letter to somebody I was working with, and I said, you're such a creative coward. I said, I cannot believe that you were the fastest sperm to reach your mother's egg when you were out of it. And I thought, there's no going back from this. It was like, you know, when George Costanza left, you know, it was like
I wanted to do that at Marvel after I had left and everything went well and we were all friends and all feelings were good. There was a retreat coming. There was a retreat last December and I knew the retreat was coming. It was the first one I hadn't been to.
Yeah.
And I was just going to show up like George Costanza. And then I forget, I think Jerry told me that, Jerry Dugan told me to sit there like Ralph Macchio with the newspaper and just don't talk to anybody. It's a very inside joke. But Stevie's laughing. But they were selling furniture for money.
I get charged for a coffee. Somebody said to me, would you like a coffee? And I was like, yes. And they said, that would be a dollar. It's like, Marvel had no money at all.
No, and then the bullpen was dark. Remember, it was all dark because they were literally keeping the lights off to save money. And I remember very clearly a wall of like knocked over filing cabinets stacked on top of each other with a post-it note that said, sold. And I literally was like, oh, am I going to write the last Spider-Man comic? Like, is this the end of the road? Like, is this why we got in? Because everybody else like left for video games and a decent paycheck. But I was like, and I remember we said, all right, so we'll write the last Marvel comics and we can tell everyone we did that. You know,
it was funny. Like, Joe was so contagious. Like, Joe Quesada had just been made editor-in-chief. And it's funny what a difference one or two people can make, isn't it? You know, like Joe Quesada and Bill James, who was president of the company at the time. And they were so charismatic and so interesting. I took a pay cut. I was making no money at DC, and I somehow took a pay cut to come back. Like, I got even less when I went to Marvel. But Joe convinced me it was like the best move I was ever making, and he was right. You know, it was great, wasn't it? Because there's nothing more interesting than to go into a company that's on its knees, because they kind of let you do something crazy.
So, like a lot of you, I'm kind of obsessed with Mark and how his brain works. And I've had like a front row seat to some great Mark moments. And one of them is at our first time we were at Marvel. But I remember the first retreat was at like a card table in the break room.
Oh, yeah.
You remember? It was like me, you, Joe, Stevie was there, and just a few other people. It was like eight people. And you said, I have an idea. Marvel zombies, but they're really zombies. And I remember there was a quiet. And I remember literally thinking, I'm embarrassed I heard that. But it was a genius idea. It was a genius idea. It was one of those, you're so brilliant at like...
Everybody in the room laughed at me.
Did oh, that's the thing. At your face.
Yes, you weren't alone. And I remember Joe saying, why did we even fly you out? And it was like, we had one of those retreats where there was like 40 people around the table. And you cracked a joke, and it was a great joke, but it was very slightly, I won't name the editor, at the editor's expense, just very slightly, I mean, it was gentle, but everybody in the room really guffawed, and Brian went, instantly ashamed, it was like classic Jewish kids, you know, he was just like, I feel so bad about this, you know, but it was a great joke, it was worth it, and even the guy laughed, right, and after, we did an 8-hour meeting, and then afterwards, I was saying, you coming for dinner, and he says, oh, I feel really bad about that joke. And I was like, it's fine, he was laughing, it's okay. And he was like, no, I feel that terrible. And he didn't come to dinner. And then I texted him and said, you coming out for a drink? And he went, no, I can't stop thinking about that joke. It was like a Woody Allen was writing his life. It was amazing.
I'm laughing because you're thinking some cute little anecdote. My wife is like, this is my daily existence. This goes on every day. I remember the joke. I know exactly what you're talking about. I still think he's upset about it. I just decided to move on. And that's why I got to write Peter Parker for 18 years. That's how my brain works.
You should text him an apology from here.
I will. There's going to be, I told my wife, I can tell him, there's going to be a lot of me in the old home, just random, whatever texting is, when we're in the old home, I'll be doing that, just apologizing for everything I've ever said or done. You drive American comic creators crazy. Do you have a sense of that?
No, not at all.
You're brassy and you say crazy all the time. You know you tweet your craziness and you know you're riding people. I know you know you're riding people.
For me this is like
that's a revelation. but you guys know like years ago started a bet with Amy Cool News about how the guy who played Jesus was going to be Superman, and then he goes, you know for a fact that guy's going to be Superman. You bet like $1,000 of my royalties for my new comic book, Kick-Ass. Was it Wanted or Kick-Ass, was that this guy's gonna be Superman, and they were in headlines about this for like a week, about that Jim Caviezel's gonna be Superman.
Is that every entertainment paper?
No, completely made it up in your basement. And
totally made it up. It was I basically spent $1,000 on publicity for the new book that I had coming.
So I find that deliriously delightful. Many people do. Other creators want to murder you. I was having a hard time co-writing. I literally was struggling with where my voice should be, where your voice would be, and you were generally like zen about it, like, yeah, do whatever you want to do, man. Don't worry about it. Just go, if you want to write it, go write it. And you did, you let me just kind of stop all over because I was being crazy. And then what I didn't know is that when it was done, you would call our editor and said, you know, because we were splitting basically the money for the book. You said, give it to Brian. And to give him the royalties, he did all the work. I wouldn't feel comfortable taking that.
Did I really do that?
Not only did you do that, you never told me, and I found out like months later that you did it. So it was like I couldn't even stop you from doing it. You picked up the check without, you know, showing me that you did it.
Let me tell you about a guy called Jesus. I learned a lot from it. But here's the
thing. I tell people who know you this story, nobody believes it. One person has said, no, that sounds like
money. There must be this weird nice side to me that I don't even recognize. That's amazing.
I think I bring out, there's a side of you, there's a Jewishness in you that I was trying to get out. And when I come, I feel this with other people too, but you, I feel, oh, I want to be Jewish. Why do I want to be Jewish? I don't even know why.
Like, and she's the only one of my kids who's done this. Now I used to do it all the time when I was a kid. Like, I've got my kids all into comics, but she actually drew her own comic all the way from start to finish, lettered it and everything, stapled it, scanned it on the printer. I don't even know how to work the printer. And she stapled it, and then she took it to a family wedding. I mentioned this yesterday in the panel, and she made £55, which was about $60, and sold it to relatives. And I said, why did you choose the wedding? And she said, they would feel they have to buy it, because the family was in it.
So learn.
Legend continues. Last year to Netflix and signed a big deal with Netflix to stay there for years and just do the sequels to the stuff that you're seeing and create new content for them. So we're creating them as television shows and movies, and I'm going to do four of those also as comic books every year too. So it's kind of, I mean, life hasn't changed that much really. I'm still just sitting at a computer typing. I wanted to be like Bruce Wayne. What's happened? How come I'm still just sitting typing and on Twitter all day? You know, I've done some films.
So you left Mark. That you left.
I left in 2009.
Okay, no one was totally sure that you left. You kind of just walked out.
I drifted. I didn't want to make a scene.
So you finished your Old Man Logan run.
Yeah.
Okay. It's funny because I mentioned that, you know, Superman was created by two little Jewish boys from Cleveland. I'm a little Jewish boy from Cleveland.
I think you were Catholic, actually.
Don't take this from me. So I mentioned there's a deep connection, and there's a lot of Judaism in the origin of Superman as well, and I brought that up, and that, of course, panicked the alt-right that we were going to have a bris or something. I don't know what they thought I was going to do. Man of Steel number one is a big circumcision issue, but...
and it's hard to be Kryptonian steel.
I got it all worked out. It's a piece of the source wall. We know how to do it. So...
when that foreskin is removed, would it turn to kryptonite? Would that actually become a deadly thing for Superman?
Well, that's next year's event. It's crisis. Anyway, so... Well,
it must be called Fantastic Foreskin. Fantastic Foreskin.
By the way, if you laugh it up, coming from Netflix next year, Fantastic Foreskin, that will not be able to stop. Anyway. I just think there's a deep spirituality in the character that comes from that origin, and I'm going to find that. So it's not like he's going to start talking, you know, like Jerry Seinfeld or anything. He's not going to, I'm not going to Jew him up. He's not a Jewish character, but I think, and then when people would tweet me, they'd go, Superman's not Jewish, he's American!
I'm going to have to send you a book. A friend of mine called Howard Jacobson, that's a Jewish intellectual back in the UK, wrote a whole book about Superman's Jewishness. You're going to love it. It's amazing. The Bottle City of Candor, you know, being like the Lost Tribe and all this kind of thing. It's amazing. I'll send it over.
No, I
love it.
Have
you seen the book?
Yeah. I'm writing Superman. You have me unmute, but unmute you see it's Superman everywhere. It's all.
I think we have another print resurgence coming up as well, because there's a 20-year cycle in comics, you know, and like there's booms and busts, and it's been a quiet time. But this last decade has been a little quieter than the previous decade, you know, 2000 to 2010. Marvel had a lot of big spikes, DC as well, you know, but it's been a little quieter over the last few years. But I think you can just smell it in the air, like something that gets people back into comic shops is the thing that spikes everything up again for the next few years. You know, we had the Civil War, the Ultimate Line, all that kind of thing. But I think Brian Superman, genuinely, it's quite a monumental thing It's like when Kirby came over in the 70s to DC, everybody was like, what the hell, that's the Marvel guy. So I think Brian coming over and at the same time multiplying that by Superman being reinvented, that's like, it's a huge deal. So I think you're going to have a lot of people coming in and, you know, all ships lift in that tide, you know. So I think people are going to come in buy Superman, but they're also going to check out other stuff while they're there. I think DC has massively upped their game, by the way. The guys are doing a brilliant job just now. Like, the Batman books are on fire. Having Brian doing the Superman books, you've got Scott going over to do Justice League. It's looking good. You know, I think you're going to have a lot of people coming in and sticking around, and everyone will benefit from it. So I think really good times ahead for the next 10 years. I think so, it'll be great.
And that's, you know, also you got to look outside the superhero military industrial complex and look at what's going on, with like Raina's work and the other graphic novelists that are having massive success outside of the comic book market.
Yeah.
I think that, on top of what you just discussed, is going to, the table is set for something very special to happen. And I'm excited for the creators that are just coming in right now. We know some of their names, and some of the names at Marvel right now, they're just coming in, like Donnie and Matthew Rosenberg and Ed Brisson and Kelly Thompson. There are some genuinely powerful voices just now about to put their foot down. And when I was making my pros and cons list about making the switch, it was like, well, if I do go, that kind of maybe frees up some books.
15 books a month?
Then maybe frees himself up to let some of the new people who I'm genuinely fans of and friends with, to maybe I should get the hell out of the way and let them have what we had, which is, remember, we had cart launch, go nuts, have a party. And that's where the Ultimate Line came from, and that's where, you know, a lot of the bigger choices that we made came from. So, yeah, it made me feel like Marvel's set to win, DC's set to win, Random House is set to win, Scholastic, everyone's really kind of set to win, where reading is, and we know, like, people aren't reading like they should, in general. And when you see comics thriving in that kind of culture, I get excited. Imagine if people really read it.
Well, the weird thing is, like, what we try to do at Netflix is also take advantage of the fact that there's going to be shows and books out at the same time, you know, of the same thing. So imagine, you know, the Game of Thrones Walking Dead relationship with print has been incredible, but you haven't always seen that translated with Marvel and DC characters. You know, it hasn't always spiked the sales. So what we were trying to do, we're launching our first big book in June. We're doing The Magic Order, the book I'm doing with Olivia Coipel. And we're going
to... Hold on, for those of you who don't speak Scottish, she said they're doing The Magic Order with Coipel.
We should have a signer now, sorry. But what our plan is like to do a launch like nobody's ever seen before. Like Marvel and DC, you know, they don't have the deep pockets, I guess, that Netflix has got too, but I mean, the campaign is going to be insane. When this thing launches in June, it's going to be like a movie. You know, it's going to be like a big, big launch for this comic. And this is a year before the TV show. I mean, we're doing this just in the print side of things, just now. So, and I think when that's a success, there'll be more of that too, and it's going to catch fire around everything, like Amazon, Hulu, all this kind of thing. Because these companies are all more and more being owned by the same people, so there's no reason that they couldn't work hand in hand. Like, I always thought Marvel and DC should work more hand in hand between print and the movie side of things. But that's our plan with Netflix going forward. And I think we're just at the beginning of something amazing. I think it'll be a couple of years before you see it really come to fruition. But I think we're entering the best period comics has ever had. It's so exciting to be in the inside.
It was about Superman's relatability and the things in his life that are unbelievably relatable that aren't really dealt with that much. And, you know, being an orphan, being adopted, being in his marriage is a trick. He's married.
They're keeping a marriage.
Don't worry about it. And there's so much about him that's very relatable, his relationship to all of his parents, all of his friends. And we're going to dig into that. I love Clark. I love Clark Kent. I love him. And he's really fascinating to write. He's actually more interesting to write than Superman. Superman's a lot of fun to write, but Clark's a really interesting character. He's made some interesting choices, so... We're going to dive in, and I can't wait to see what people react to positively and negatively. So I'm always fascinated by my internal duality of my neurotic self-doubt and my unbelievable ego that wrestle. And as a writer, there's an ego that's involved. I would like you to read my story, but the craft of it comes with all this
writers, they have to be egomaniacs by our nature. Because if you think about it, we think that what we have to say is so interesting that other people want to hear it all over the world, and not only hear it, pay money to hear it. I mean, that's weird, isn't it? It's kind of a weird way to make a living.
So that when you put it that way, yeah.
But so make sure as you're game, you think this is $3.99 every time somebody reads this. So I always think I don't want somebody feeling ripped off. Yeah. But in terms of feeling that you have to have your game with other creators, like, have you ever taken over a book that was beloved just before you came on? You know, because Matthew Vaughn, the guy who directed Kingsmen, he said to me it was amazing doing X-Men First Class, because everybody hated X3, and he said it was great, you know, because expectations were so low. You know?
No, but we grew up in that, like Frank Millar, the story of Frank Millar is that Daredevil was going to get canceled.
Yeah.
So get a book like that and blow the roof off the
place. I'll notice all
that. If they cancel it,
yeah,
they were going to cancel it anyhow. If you save it, you're Frank Millar, yeah. Right? So, that would be my philosophy most times, is take a book that is struggling. In this case, actually, Superman's actually doing really well. They actually just put down like 3 or 4 really good Superman stories this year. So I went, oh, what you learn as you get older, and I will say that, and I'm sure Mark agrees that though earlier weird things would motivate you. Yeah, maybe jealousy, or like I would be like obsessed with like Mike Allred's success with Mad Men, because we were struggling indie guys and Mad Men had yo-yos and cups and merchandise, and I'd be like, why don't I have this? But I've apologized to him. That would motivate some, you know, jealousy would motivate a little bit, but as you get older, that all goes away, and it all becomes about craft. It becomes about this thing costs $3.99 or whatever. I would like this to be really good, and I would like it to be honest, and that's my thing.
How good
the last few years is how much honesty is in this book.